Friends, grace and peace, good morning and welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church. No matter if you have joined us before or if this is your first time, we are so excited that you have stopped in to worship with us this morning. We want to be sure that we welcome you, so if you would, we'd invite you to click the link in the description, which will take you over to a connection card. That card asks for just a little bit of information, but it lets us know who's worshiping with us and gives us a way to contact you just to say thanks for being with us this morning. I also want to let you know that we're going to try something a little bit different starting today. We believe that worship isn't just something we simply watch, but rather worship is something that God invites us to participate in. So with that in mind, after the sermon, we're going to post some questions on the screen. We want to invite you to think about those questions, maybe talk about them with those sitting next to you, or post your thoughts and comments in the comments section of this worship video. Worship should engage us, so we hope that this might help us do that more as we continue to worship together through video. So as we come together for worship this morning, join me in our opening prayer. In awe and wonder, we meet you here, O God, for you are the God of prophets and priests, widows, orphans, and the God of us. We have struggled with you in lonely places, and we have praised you in the company of your people. We have cried out to you, and you have shown us your steadfast love. We have resisted you, and yet you have drawn us back into the circle of Christ's disciples. Pour out your presence on us who have gathered for worship. Hear our prayers, listen to our praise, and renew our spirits. Amen. Thank you. knowing that not one of us is perfect, knowing that each and every one of us falls short of God's expectations, let us join together as we offer the prayer of confession. Merciful God, our loyalties have been divided, and we have taken your grace for granted. You seek us out, but we attempt to go our own way. You provide, but we hoard. You free us from enslavement to sin, but we neglect to be instruments of righteousness. You welcome us as we are, but we refuse to receive others in your name. Forgive what we have been. Amend what we will be. Awaken us to the new thing you are doing within and around us. Send your Spirit to shape us in ways that better reflect the one we claim to follow, Jesus Christ. And hear, O God, these silent prayers of confession. People of God, hear this. This is the good news of the gospel, and it is for you and for all. Whatever you have done, whatever you have failed to do, whoever you are, whoever you wish you were but are not, you are accepted, you are welcomed, you are forgiven, you are set free. In the love of Jesus Christ, you are loved forever. As people assured of God's love for us, let us now turn and offer signs of peace and signs of love to one another. Friends, may the peace of Christ be with you. Our gospel reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 10th chapter, verses 40 through 42. Let us listen for a word from God this morning. Jesus said to them, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, long before Jack and Elwood Blues declared that they were brothers on a mission from God, there were people and groups throughout the ancient world on a mission as well. The people of Israel were on a mission to be God's light to the nations. Cynic philosophers were on a mission from Zeus to show how much the world had wandered. Rome, they were on their own special mission. They were on a mission to be the empire without end, serving as lords of the world with the intent to crown peace with justice, to spare the vanquished, and to crush the proud. There was a heavy emphasis on crushing. Everywhere you looked, though, during this time period, people and groups and nations had a specific purpose. So it shouldn't come as a surprise for us that along the murky shores of Galilee stood 12 men on a mission as well. Gathering around their charismatic leader, this group of teens, young adults at most, listen in as they are told the details of their purpose. As you go, make this announcement, their leader says. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those with skin disease, and throw out demons. But don't take a backpack for the road. Don't pack an extra shirt or an extra pair of sandals. Don't even bring a walking stick for your journey. Whatever city or village you go into, find somebody in it who is worthy and stay there until you go on your way. When you go into a house, say, peace. If the house is worthy, give it your blessing of peace. But if the house isn't worthy, take back your blessing. If anyone refuses to welcome you or listen to your words, shake the dust off your feet as you leave that house or city. Look, I am sending you as sheep among wolves. Therefore, be wise as snakes and innocent as doves. Watch out for people, because they will hand you over to councils, and they will beat you in their synagogues. They will haul you in front of governors and even kings because of me, so that you may give your testimony to them and to the Gentiles. Brothers and sisters will hand each other over to be executed. A father will turn in his own child. Children will defy their parents and have them executed. Everyone will hate you on account of my name. That's the mission of these 12 men whom we've come to know as apostles. That's the mission of this charismatic leader that we have come to know as Jesus. It starts all out well, declaring that the kingdom of God has come near, where the sick will be healed and the dead will be raised, where disease will disappear and demons will be vanquished. But the good news of that kingdom quickly dissolves away as Jesus continues his description of this mission, one which includes beatings and execution, derision and loss of family members. The mission, as it turns out, isn't quite like the other missions they are accustomed to. This mission won't look like the Jewish priests offering their prayers in the temple or philosophers teaching their lessons in the schools. It won't even look like Roman soldiers stationed on every street corner in order to maintain peace. No, this assignment is one which will send them out into the world with almost nothing. And yet it is one that has the potential to cost them everything. As Jesus begins to conclude his description of the work that needs to be done, I'm certain that those newly commissioned 12 begin to nervously shift a little, their feet sinking a little deeper into that lakeshore sand in hopes of anchoring themselves even for just a brief moment longer before they're uprooted and sent out like sheep to wolves. And it's at this point that Jesus notices their discomfort and their worry, and he offers them those three verses that we have read this morning. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me. Whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. I like to think that this is Jesus' way of reassuring his apostles that the mission he is sending them on is indeed righteous and worthy and important. And the truth is that declaring the kingdom of God has come near is all of those things. But for Jesus, to place the kingdom of God alongside a system of rewards starts to make me nervously shift a little. My feet try to sink deeper into the floor while I attempt to understand exactly what he means. Because when Jesus starts talking about receiving rewards, I can't help but be transported back to Hartsfield-Jackson Airport in Atlanta, Georgia. It was there, at the busiest airport in the world, that I spent countless hours roaming through the terminals while waiting for the planes which would whisk me away from my first-year seminary studies and back to Tulsa for family gatherings and holidays and the occasional church meeting. What I came to realize in that airport was that without fail, no matter if I was coming or going, someone would always step in front of me on that crowded concourse and say, "Excuse me, sir, are you a Delta Rewards member?" This solicitation became so common, in fact, that I would often move to the other side of the walkway just to avoid their kiosks. Or if I couldn't move over, I would flash a random credit card in my wallet and say, "Already got one," as I walked by. Even though Delta Airlines wore me down, eventually they got me. Enticed by all the rewards and all the promises of perks, I finally stopped when that person stepped in front of me that last time and asked, "Excuse me, sir, are you a Delta Rewards member?" It's been almost 10 years now since I stopped at that kiosk in the Atlanta airport. And what I should have known then, but I know better now, is that those rewards that were so important to me only showed up when I first gave them something. The reason why Jesus' words make us shift a little is because rewards programs are transactional. Buy an airline ticket, get points in return. Buy two cheeseburgers, get one free. Welcome a profit, get a profit's reward. In this transactional system, we act in ways that already anticipates what we get in return. Nir Eyal is the author of Hooked, How to Build Habit-Forming Products, and he makes the point that we live in a world that is constantly rewarding us with what he calls pings, dings, and rings, which prompt us to action. They're triggers, but they're also rewards in and of themselves. When we hear the ring of a text message, it's a reminder that we are not alone. When we get dinged with emails, it's a message that says we are somehow important. And so we respond to these notifications because whether we recognize it or not, we are anticipating a reward of more pings, dings, or rings. And I think Jesus knows that about us. While this transactional system might bring up those long-standing debates of works righteousness or irresistible grace, Jesus might actually be ahead of us on this one. In his commentary on the Gospel of Matthew, Wesley Allen points out for us that this is actually the climax of encouragement for Jesus. After naming the hardships that will be part of the church's mission, which means many will reject the proclamation and the service of the church, naming the rewards of those who welcome the ones sent out signals that even in spite of the hardships, the mission will ultimately be successful. There's no need to talk about rewards if this is not the case. So rather than reading this as Jesus handing out merit badges for good deeds, we may want to see this as Christ's hopeful encouragement to us as the church. That even through strife and hardship, God's kingdom does and will come near. I can't think of better news than that in the times that we find ourselves in. Because each new day seems to bring with it a new set of dire warnings and concerns. Coronavirus is spiking across the United States and especially here in Oklahoma. Debate rages on as to how to best address systemic racism. City council chambers are packed with citizens hoping to have their voices heard, and there's no clear end in sight for any of this. And yet, through it all, the mission of God goes on. We are still sent out into the world in order to declare that the kingdom of heaven has come near, where the sick are healed and the dead are raised, where disease disappears and demons are vanquished. It's not some far-off hope, but it's a present reality. It's not some anticipated reward, but it is our current call. I'm sure that as those 12 stood along the lakeshore in Galilee, they felt utterly overwhelmed with the task ahead of them. And I am certain that we, the church, feel the same way. There is so much work to be done. And the circumstances that we find ourselves in make that work so much more difficult to do. But I'm again reminded by the words that I have shared before by Rabbi Tarfon when he commented, "Do not be daunted by the enormity of the world's grief. Do justice now. Love mercy now. Walk humbly now. You are not obligated to complete the work, but neither are you free to abandon it." We do the work of the kingdom of God not because it's easy and not for some prize. We do the work of the kingdom of God because it is here, it is real, and because it is good news. In the name of the Creator, the Christ, and the Spirit. Amen. One of the ways that we do the work of the kingdom of God here and now is by lifting up prayers to God for families and friends and neighbors and for the world. And so join me as I pray this morning. Lord God, we bow in prayer, humbled by the reality that you want to spend time with us. You long to be in relationship with us. You receive us and care for us no matter where we have been, what we have done, or how often we have neglected your call. Such knowledge is too wonderful for us. Such grace is beyond our comprehension. And so we rest in your compassionate presence, freed from sin and alive to the transformation that you promise. Awed by your mercy and kindness, we seek to respond with bold faith. Strengthen our resolve to follow where Christ leads and obey his commandment to love one another. In a world overflowing with anger and division, send us to be ambassadors of reconciliation. In the wake of injustice and pain, use us as instruments of righteousness and healing. As creation groans for relief, make us bearers of hope and catalysts of life-giving change. And so this morning we ask you to provide healing to the sick. We look to you to ease the suffering of those hurting in body, mind, and spirit. We plead on behalf of the long oppressed and for those still waiting for justice. We yearn for you to guide all of those in positions of leadership to make decisions that reflect your will. And we rest in your compassionate presence, freed from sin, alive and awaiting the transformation that you promise. And so we make our prayer in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. family of God, we have been called out into the world on a mission to declare that the kingdom of God has come near, even now, but especially now. So as we shift nervously, remember these words from Rabbi Tarfon. Do not be daunted by the enormity of the world's grief. Do justice now. Love mercy now. Walk humbly now. You are not obligated to complete the work, but neither are you free to abandon it. And so also remember that no matter who you are, no matter what you do, no matter where you go, you are loved. You are loved by Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who rests with each and every one of us, tonight, tomorrow, and forever. Amen.